An honor to be here. Thank you so much. I'm grateful to the sponsors. I'm grateful to you. You get to change the nation because you have the power to do that right here. It's a wonderful time to be alive. Ronald Reagan said, "We're lucky not to live in pale and timid times. We've been blessed with the opportunity to stand for something, for liberty and freedom and fairness. And these are things worth fighting for, worth devoting our lives to. Yes, D.C. is a sandbox out of control. No doubt about it. No doubt about it. Senator Ligon did a wonderful job on the foundations of federalism. But if we got a sandbox out of control, we have to communicate at a sandbox level. You with me? Right? So let's think about this for a second. Let's think about what he said. I want you to stand up for a second. Humor me here. How many of you have ever been in a tug of war? Raise your hand. It's pretty much everybody, okay? I want you to imagine a tug of war, okay? And we bring up here two teams. And we get the biggest fella in the room. I'm not going to point you out. There's one. We got a volunteer. We get 14 people up here, and we make them raise their hand at the start and say, "I promise to pull on that rope, no matter what," right? And we say, "Okay, now divide into your two teams." And our big fella goes to one side, and the 13 go to the other. You think, well, that's no contest at all. And as Senator Ligon pointed out, indeed, it should not be a contest at all. But the game is not to win. You know, pull one side over to the other. That's not the game in this unprecedented system of federalism. What they set up was a system to hold that flag directly in the middle. And you had that healthy tension to hold that flag right in the middle. That flag is life, liberty, property, self-governance. And that healthy tension is to hold that flag right in the middle. And our big guy is just pulling to beat all. And the 13 over here, they're barely breaking a sweat. And if you ask him, "Could you pull him over?" Oh, clearly. We could pull him over at our will. Don't do it, because remember the object. Keep that flag right in the middle, right? But one by one, the 13 said, "God, you know, I'm afraid I might look funny up here doing this. I'm going to drop off the rope. I'm getting kind of tired. I don't remember why we're up here in the first place. I got so much other stuff to do." And they drop off the rope. And as they drop off the rope, the big guy gets more emboldened. And he pulls harder until they've all dropped off the rope. And guess what? The big fella, he's got all the rope over on his side with the flag at his feet. Remember the object? Keep the flag perfectly balanced in the middle. Are we doing that? No, clearly we're failing. So the big fella gets an idea. We say, "You know what I'm going to do? Since the flag is all over here, I'm going to push on the end of the rope. I'm going to push that flag back into balance." And no, it doesn't work. Why? You can't push balance. It requires that healthy tension. So what do our 13 do? Now they got to get out of their comfort zone. And they got to go over there, and they got to grab that rope, and they got to bring it back over, and they got to pull. They've got to pull. You cannot push federalism. We and those that we elect in our neighborhoods and in our districts and our counties and our cities and our states have to pull federalism. It might be nice to have a big fellow that's encouraging and supporting and cheerleading, but we have to pull federalism. So I'm Ken Ivory. I am, most importantly, a dad with an obligation. To secure the blessings of liberty to my posterity. That's what I signed on to do. That's why I put my law practice aside. I had this nice life, you guys. I had this nice life. I used to go to girls' camp and scout camp. I actually made money. You know, it was really great. And then we signed on because I have an obligation, as do you, as do we all in our own sphere. Your obligation is as important as your sphere, as mine and Senator Ligon and others is in theirs. We all have a job to do. We all have a part to play in pulling on that rope. American Lands Council. I'm a state representative. I'm also the president of the American Lands Council. I passed a bill. Counties came to me and said, "You've got to lead the charge on this. We've got an issue where the federal government controls more than one-third of the real estate in the United States of America. In a nation founded on liberty, property, and self-governance, the federal government controls more than one-third of the real estate in the United States. More than 50% of all land in the western United States, more than 67% of my state, more than 85% of the state of Nevada. I have counties that have less than 3% taxable land. Can you imagine? We're leading the charge to secure the transfer of federal lands to the states, just like has already been done. Now, we're not talking about the stuff on the right. We're talking about this. National parks, off the table. Military bases, Indian reservations, off the table. We're not talking about those. We're talking about millions and millions of productive acres that are locked up and, in fact, being devastated. We'll talk about that as we go. Liberty cannot exist. Hence, life has no real meaning without the right and control of property. So I would submit to you that this is not a Western issue. The right and control of property. If we're pulling on that rope, I need you pulling on that rope for property and liberty as much as you need me in Utah pulling on that rope for your liberty and property and self-governance. But let me show you why this is not a Western issue. In fact, South Carolina did a resolution supporting the transfer of public lands. Republican National Committee, unanimous resolution supporting the transfer of public lands. The National Association of Counties added it to their platform, the transfer of public lands, as did the American Farm Bureau. And hundreds of organizations, local, state, and national, have passed resolutions supporting the transfer of public lands. Let's look at why. Transfer of public lands is the only solution big enough, I would submit to you. Because as the Supreme Court said just last year, the constitutional equality of the states is essential to the harmonious operation of the republic. Think about that for a second. The oldest political tactic in the book, divide and conquer. Divide and conquer. If I can make some of you less powerful or at a disparity, now we can divide and conquer. The constitutional equality of the estates is essential to the harmonious operation of the republic, Supreme Court said just last year. We have the opportunity to balance the federal budget and reduce and eliminate the national debt. We have that opportunity, I'll show you that. But this is where we're at. And we're adding $1 trillion a year in deficit, but in the accrual basis, we're adding $5 trillion a year in the obligations that are coming. This is serious, this is mission critical serious. Secure the domestic supply of natural resources. Right now, our military is wholly dependent, as are all your technology. All your technology, every piece of it, requires rare earth minerals to operate. Our military technology requires rare earth minerals to operate. You know where 95% of them come from? China. How's that for a national defense strategy? But guess what? They're locked up all over the western lands. We have more than, get this, $150 trillion. Dollars in mineral value, locked up in federally controlled lands, according to the Institute for Energy Research. We have the opportunity to achieve energy independence, to actually achieve energy independence, because according to the Government Accountability Office, 2 years ago testifying to Congress, there is more recoverable oil just in Utah, Colorado, and Wyoming than the rest of the world combined, locked up in federally controlled lands. This is not a Western issue. We have the opportunity to protect our environment, wildlife, watershed, our recreational lands that are right now being devastated. Under failed federal policies, we're burning nearly 7 million acres of federal forest a year, destroying the watershed, wildlife. We're burning millions of animals, destroying their habitat. We're burning protected species in the name of protecting these endangered species, and we call that, at Washington, environmentalism. Go figure. There's a sandbox problem in Washington, no doubt about it. Access, roads are being closed all over the West. All over the West. In fact, in Utah, we have 1 million acres of school trust land that we own as a state. We can't get to them. Because they're all surrounded by federally controlled lands, we can't even access them. Imagine what that does to funding education. We have forests that are rotting all over the West. And even after the fires go through and there's still serviceable timber, guess what? Can't harvest even the deadwood. It sits to rot, pumping CO2 into the atmosphere instead of sequestering that. If you're an environmentalist, you should care about transferring the land to more local, responsible, responsive control, putting it under state stewardship. You all remember a year ago that the federal government just decided in their sandbox struggle, we're just going to close the national parks. Guess what? That's an $8 billion industry to the state of Utah that was closed overnight. Closed overnight. We can't afford not to get more responsive and responsible management of these lands for the benefit of the nation. So look at this for just a second. Federally controlled lands, the top right, access being shut off. Wilderness areas and roadless rules. You see why we're distressed in the West with what's happening. Wildfires, more than 250 acres. $150 trillion in mineral value locked up. You see an opportunity there? You see a solution? And where you set the national agenda, do you see an opportunity there, the young lady in the back, for real solutions? If we're pulling on the rope? So you're the key. You are absolutely the key, because you have to vet candidates that have, number one, the knowledge and the courage to battle for, not battle against anyone or anything. We've got to forget the sandbox. It's too late for that. Things are too mission critical. We have to battle for liberty, property, self-governance. Through this transfer of federal lands to local control, you get better access, better health, and better productivity for the security of the nation. So three self-evident principles, okay? Governments exist to secure these rights, which were endowed by our Creator. That's why government exists, to secure these rights. Governments exist among men, deriving their just powers from consent of the governed. To secure these rights, governments exist among men. Governments, all governments. Well, what rights? Life, clearly. Liberty, clearly. Property, the pursuit of happiness. That's what all the state constitutions said. That's what John Locke said. Life, liberty, property, self-governance. That when any of these forms become oppressive, it's the right to alter or abolish them. That government resides here. That's the foundation. We've got three self-evident principles. Governments exist to secure these rights. Liberty cannot exist. Hence, life has no real meaning without the right and control of property. George Sullivan, the only member of the United States Supreme Court from Utah. We're pretty proud of him. Look at what he said. Man has three great rights. They're so interconnected as to be a single right. Because if you give a man his life, but you take away his liberty, you take away all that gives life its meaning. If you give him his liberty, but take away the property, which is the fruit and the badge of his liberty, you still leave him a slave. Property is critical. The third fundamental self-evident principle, the constitutional equality of the states, is essential to the harmonious operation of the republic. We need equal states to pull on that rope. Clearly they have enough power, but if you can divide and conquer and separate them amongst themselves, we know what happens in the tug of war. But that healthy tension is critical, that we have equal states. Three fundamental truths, okay? The statehood terms. A lot of people say, well, somehow, I don't know what happened in the West. The federal government ran out of gas when it got to Colorado. And they just forgot how to dispose of land. The statehood terms are the same. Word for word, the same. It's already been done before. And as we talked about, it's the only solution big enough. This is North Dakota and South Dakota's Enabling Act, their statehood contract, side by side with Utah. You see the difference there? You see why North Dakota should have 3% federally controlled lands and Utah should have 67, and North Dakota should have a $6 billion rainy day fund, and North Dakota should put billions of dollars into classrooms. North Dakota is generating economies all over the United States, equipment manufacturers, suppliers, financing, engineering, accounting. You see the difference there? Let's go like this. Word for word the same. Why the difference? Nobody's been able to answer that question. So there came a time when the states began dropping off the rope. When they got to Illinois and Indiana and Michigan and Iowa and Missouri and Arkansas and Louisiana, Alabama and Mississippi. And I want you to look way over there. You see that great western state clear over there of Florida? They were 90% federally controlled for decades. 90% federally controlled for decades. Here's what their complaints were. They sent resolutions to Congress. They're on the American Lands Council website. Their resolutions to Congress, they said, we can't educate our children. You're controlling all our land. We can't grow our economy. You're controlling all our land and resources. You're hoarding all of our resources. Our people are leaving our states to find jobs in other places. Does that sound familiar when people say, oh, those western states just whining out there? That was Illinois. That was Florida. Florida said we're the worst off of all the western states in their resolution to Congress. But they banded together. And they battled for, not against anyone or anything, they battled for the only solution big enough. They're not 90% federally controlled today. They were led by Democratic Senator Thomas Hart Benton. You may remember him. He's in the book Profiles in Courage, written by JFK. He's one of the half a dozen people in there. Look what he says. He says, my election to the Senate found me doing battle for an ameliorated system of disposing of the public lands. I moved against the whole system. I resolved to move against the whole system. I did it in a bill, but more so in speeches. We've got to educate and teach because we can't do what we don't know. And rights we don't know are no better than rights we don't have. In speeches all around the nation that changed the public mind, that's what you have the opportunity to do. You are the starting point to change the public mind. Teddy Roosevelt of Thomas Hart Benton said, he began his fight for disposing of the public land during John Quincy Adams' administration. He said, it was a move of enormous importance to the whole West. He said, as a whole, look what he says in the middle there. He had to encounter much opposition, especially from the short-sighted selfishness of many of the Northeasterners, present company excluded. As a whole, his theory of a liberal system of land distribution was undoubtedly the correct one. And he deserves credit for having pushed it as he did. Illinois is not 90% federally controlled today. Florida is not 90% federally controlled today. Louisiana, Alabama, they had the exact same term in their Enabling Act with respect to the transfer of the federally controlled land. So we see this again. We have an opportunity. You have an opportunity to drive the national agenda to better access, better health, and better productivity. We have the opportunity to be environmentalists in the truest sense of the word. And to secure national defense, to provide a thriving national economy so we're not a geopolitical laughingstock as we are now. Three pillars of success, okay? Education, legislation, and litigation. Education, this is what we're doing today. You have the opportunity, get on the American Lands Council website. This information, the video that'll be available from this, share that with everyone you know. What other $150 trillion solution are you aware of? That goes right back to our fundamental principles of life, liberty, property, self-governance. Educate. We have to hire and inspire leaders, as Bill was mentioning, Senator Ligon was mentioning. We have to hire and inspire leaders. It starts with you right here. Legislation's already happening. Six states have already passed legislation, working on legislative action in the West to secure the transfer of public lands. South Carolina did a resolution supporting the Western states. Why would they do that? Do you realize that you all are spending about $10 billion a year in taxes extracted from you to pay Western communities to not use their own lands and resources to care for our own children and communities? We'd like to invite you to knock that off for the benefit of everyone. Not only is it a principle of the equality of states, not only does it get to better access, better health, better productivity, but you're spending $10 billion a year to burn 7 million acres of our forest, to shut off access to our school trust lands and our recreational places, and lock up trillions in resources. There is a solution forward. It starts with you. Education. Legislation is already happening, local, state, national. We've got members of Congress that are starting to work on legislation on this. That's going to require your support. That's going to require you making this a national issue with the great things you do right here. You are the seedbed right here. At the national level, legislation is already moving forward. Litigation, back here. Litigation, Utah appropriated $2 million this year to begin the litigation effort. We have Supreme Court cases as recently as last year where they said the constitutional equality of the states, our nation was and is a union of states equal in power, dignity, and authority, just last year. 5 years ago, the Supreme Court said Congress doesn't have the authority to simply change unilaterally the terms of a state statehood, particularly where all of a state's public lands are at stake. They don't have the authority. That makes sense to us, but to have the Supreme Court say that helps us out. Don't be fooled by the three myths. They say your land is arid. That's why you don't get your land. Your land is arid. Arid, Alaska, Oregon, Washington. These are law professors, political science professors. Your land is arid, therefore the federal government keeps it. You just gave up your land at statehood. You know those pioneers that went out there for liberty and property and self-governance? Their first act of statehood, they just gave up the land. They actually say these things with a straight face. And then they'll say, well, you can't manage your own land. Thank you. Like they can, right? A lot more we could talk about that. Time's running low. But these are Alabama's Enabling Act, same terms. Louisiana, same terms. Nebraska, same exact language that they say is the reason that we shouldn't be able to control our own land. It's all available on the website. North and South Dakota, word for word, the same as Utah, Montana, Washington. States. Nevada just finished a study a couple months ago. Utah study comes out in a couple of weeks. States already manage millions of acres of public land. Utah, we generate $33 an acre positive net revenue. You see New Mexico there, $50-plus dollars an acre positive net revenue. Federal government, well, they lose 91 cents an acre. And they say, we can't manage the land. Well, clearly, we can't afford to manage the land the way the federal government does with policies that are management by litigation. We can't afford not to manage the land the way states already manage millions of acres. More charts. I love this one. I love this one. When they say you can't afford to manage these lands. The state of Washington has its own forestry department. Look down in the lower left there. The state of Washington is only, mind you, only 1,283 times more effective at generating revenue per acre than the U.S. Forest Service. And yet the argument is the states can't afford to manage their own lands. Clearly we can't afford not to. Public policy statement on the website, when people bring up issues, oh, you're going to sell off all the land. No, federal public land becomes state public land for multiple use with local planning for better access, health, productivity. It's available on the website. Three things you can do. Sign up at the website. Get on there right now. Join the team. This is an issue that is a solution. It's a real solution based right in our fundamental principles. And then also get on the Facebook page. Share that with others. Education is critical, and you are the key. There's a petition on there. Sign and share the petition. I demand that you transfer the federal lands to willing Western states for better access, better health, better productivity. Do it right now. If there's any reason you can't do it now, make sure you do it today. Sign up on that. This is a movement that is sweeping the United States because it's a real solution based in our fundamental principles. And then, as has been talked about, you start this whole thing off. You are the key to hire and inspire leaders that have the knowledge and the courage to battle for the only solution big enough to deal with national security, environmental health, better access, better health, better productivity of our lands. You can text SIGN to 801-416-2543, and that'll get you in and be part of that. We one email a week, 3 minutes, that's all we do, and then with other things going on. We have to band together. We have to pull together. As we pull together, what Senator Ligon was talking about becomes possible. What this young lady back here was frustrated about becomes possible. We have a system problem. W. Edwards Deming, the patron saint of just-in-time manufacturing in Japan, I used to work for the mayor of the city of Osaka in the International Relations Department, he said, every system is perfectly designed to achieve the results that it gets. Do you like the results we're getting? We have a system problem. We have a system problem. We have a rope sitting in a pile on one side of the balance. It requires that healthy tension, and without that, we're going to continue to have a system problem. That starts with you. Thomas Hart Benton said, but the members of Congress from the new states he was talking about, Illinois, Florida, Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi, the new states should not intermit their exertions or vary their policy, but should fix their eyes steadily upon the period of the speedy extinction of the federal title to all the lands within their respective limits. And they did. constitutional equality of the states is fundamental. Nation wasn't in a union of states, equal in power, dignity, and authority. Thomas Jefferson, it's in this little book. By the way, just a couple things. So you've got, here's a little cheat sheet when you're meeting with folks that come to town. These are up on the table. You've got the three of the four maps, and you've got the questions as you start confronting them right there. You've got little cards. Take as many of these as you need. You've got little cards. That map tells the whole story. It tells the whole story. Thomas Jefferson told us what we need to do. He said it must be the states themselves erecting barriers at the constitutional line that cannot be surmounted. And John Dickinson, a founder that's too little remembered, he said the government of each state is and is to be sovereign and supreme in all matters that relate to each state only and subordinate barely in those matters that relate to the whole, and it would be their own faults. It would be their own faults if the states suffer the federal sovereignty to interfere in the things of their respective jurisdictions. So why the difference? This is not a Western issue, and we need your help, particularly right here. So the question was, where's the line? Let me just close with this. Remember where we started? We started out, this is a wonderful time to be alive. This is a wonderful time to be alive. We are lucky not to live in pale and timid times. We've been blessed with the opportunity to stand for something, for liberty and freedom and fairness and the right and control of property. These are things worth fighting for, worth devoting our lives to. So let us go forth with good cheer and stout hearts, happy warriors, after seize back a country and a world of freedom. Thank you very much.